amazing grace. Sijakusikia? Tell him amazing grace, or tell her amazing grace.
Amazing grace.
What is grace? Bwana asifiwe. What is grace? Usiniambie ni Mama Joy. Bwana asifiwe. What do you understand by the term grace? What is the biblical definition of the word grace?
Unmerited
favor.
Dispensation of God unto man.
Dispensation of God unto man. I like that. Any other understanding? For you to understand what grace is, the biblical definition of grace, you have to locate where God initiated grace. Where did grace start in the Bible? Was it after Jesus Christ died on the cross, then we received that grace? No. When do you think grace began? Yes?
In the Garden of Eden.
Wow. You seem to be a bright student, eh? What has he feel?
Amen.
Let's go to the book of Genesis, chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. We commemorate the death of Jesus Christ, and we know that it is by his death on the cross that he paid our debt, so that we can get the forgiveness and God can now move into our lives. Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Let's see what the Bible defines about the grace that we commemorate in Easter. Grace started way before Easter happened in this world, before the Son of Man was manifested in this earth. The Bible says, Genesis chapter 3, verse 21, also for Adam and his wife, the Lord God made tunics of skin and clothed them. Hallelujah. What do we understand by God clothing Adam and his wife? Before they sinned, they were in communion with God. But after they sinned, their eyes were opened and they realized that they were naked. So it meant that as far as they were naked, as long as they were naked, they will never move close to God. Make that a point in your life. As long as you are naked, you can never move close to God. Picture this. You are in your house. You don't have any clothes to wear. You cannot leave that house. Why? You will feel ashamed to meet anyone. So God saw that there was a gap between him and the man whom he had created. So God thought, like, if I clothe these people, they can come back openly to speak to me or to commune with me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So as we look at that verse, we picture grace as a means of peace. Grace means peace. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because there was lack of peace between God and man. Man had something in his heart. He was being haunted by the nakedness in him. So for God to restore the peace that used to be in the life of Adam before they fell, God had to clothe them. And after they were clothed, it is when they were now restored. They now had the boldness to come before God, and God spoke to them and released that judgment. God will not speak and release judgment against them while they were hiding somewhere in the bush. They had to come out so that God would speak to them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What happened between them coming out of the bush and them being clothed? The Bible is clear about the nature of covering that God gave them. It was a tunic of skin. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Trees or plants do not have skin. It is obviously that an animal was slain. I don't know if it was a lamb. I don't know if it was a leopard. I don't know if it was an elephant. But God slaughtered an animal, took out its skin, and covered these people. That means there was a ritual that was done. There was a blood ritual in the Garden of Eden. Hallelujah. Amen. So for that restoration to come back, for that peace to be initiated, for that grace to come, there had to be a ritual of blood. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And the Bible is clear about it. It was a covering. Hallelujah. It was a covering. So it means that one day there could be a possibility that the covering will come off. Maybe akitaka ende yaoge, hata oge na hiyo nguo. Is it true? So in such instances, they would be naked again. So it was only a covering. It was a temporary ritual that was done in the Old Testament by God himself. Years moved, prophecies came about the Messiah up to his manifestation in the New Testament. Bwana asifiwe. Even though God gave them a covering, God still saw that there was a gap. Why? Because there was a window for these people to be uncovered again. There was a window for that peace to lack between God and man. That is why God decided to make another form of grace, another form of ritual that will not cover now, but will completely seal the nakedness. Bwana asifiwe. Are we together?
Amen.
That is when Jesus Christ was now manifested in this world. He was now sent as a Son of God to come and die. And we see that it is by his blood that we have been cleansed. It is by the blood of Jesus that we have received that grace in our lives. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What an amazing grace. Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9. If you are there, say amen.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 9. Verse 22. It speaks about the laws, the law of grace. It speaks about the law of grace. Hebrews 9 verse 22, the Bible says, "And according to the law, almost all things are purified with blood, and without shedding of blood, there is no remission." Hallelujah.
Amen.
This speaks about remission of sin. So we can see the importance of the death of Jesus Christ at the cross. So when we celebrate Easter, we have to celebrate it as grace that we received. Hallelujah. We have to celebrate it or to commemorate it as grace or a favor that God gave us, as a purification. The Bible is clear here about purification. So at Easter, we celebrate our purification. Before Jesus died on the cross, what did he tell women who were crying for him? He told them, "Cry for your generations, cry for your sons, cry for your daughters." Why was Jesus speaking this? Because I am going to bring a covering, a washing away. I'm going to seal the deal of peace between you and God. But it depends on how your generation will accept it. Bible says that God gave his son so that whoever believes in him, it is not automatic that when Jesus died, all will be saved. Bwana asifiwe. That is the most dangerous part. Not all will be saved. I may come to church, but if I do not believe in him, if I do not confess him as my savior, there is no salvation for me. same to any other person. Even if you do good things, even if you move in church and participate in every activity without confessing Christ as your Savior, without accepting Him for the work that He did at the cross, there is no place for you in heaven. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hebrews 12. The book of Hebrews 12. Let's see how grace works. The grace is amazing. The grace is wonderful. But unless you are keen to understand it deeper, you can be misplaced. We now see in the world many denominations or churches have come out with their way of doctrines which are aligned to grace. We have seen that many people claim that God doesn't look unto your physical, but He looks unto your heart. And that has misled people, because people are moving in and out of the church the way they like, thinking that the God is a modernized God. Yet the Bible says that our God is an ancient God. If it's the God who made a covering by a ritual, and He sealed the deal of grace by a ritual, it means that He's a God who never changes. He's that same ancient God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hebrews 12 from verse 14. Hebrews 12 verse 14. Grace is peace. This speaks about grace. Hebrews 12:14. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Without Jehovah Shalom, you can't see the Lord. We only see God at the point of peace. When your heart is at peace with God, which is when you can see Him. 15. Looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled. Praise God.
Amen.
I studied about bitterness in the Bible, and I came to understand that bitterness can lead you to God or can lead you to damnation.
Amen.
Any man born of a woman, anyone who is born after Adam, there is a point in life that you have to come to bitterness. In fact, when you ask many people, their point of salvation was a point of bitterness. Hallelujah. So when you come to a point of bitterness, if you don't handle it well, you'll either go to damnation or it will lead you back to God. So the Bible is clear about being careful. It speaks about looking carefully, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled. It is bitterness that defiles the children of God. Verse 16, let there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For you know that afterward, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought it diligently with tears. Hallelujah.
Amen.
What do we learn from that verse? Grace is there for us, but grace expires. Grace has a time of expiring. Esau despised the grace that was given to him as a firstborn. But when he came to realization of what he had lost, he repented, yes, but he didn't find room for forgiveness, even though he cried in tears. So we may celebrate our Lord Jesus Christ as the giver of grace. We may celebrate being in church. We may celebrate the favors and the goodness of God. But if we do not make use of that grace, when it is lifted, I tell you, there is no point of return. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Last Sunday, our pastor was speaking about the period after rapture. What did he mention? Grace will be lifted. You'll have to save yourself by your blood, you'll have to make your own ritual. So you can imagine if God has made a ritual for you so that you can just sneak in, but you despise that grace, it will reach a time that you'll have to find your own grace. How many people are ready to die for their lives? Only one person. Let me tell you something. Yesterday in the morning, I woke up very early and I had a slight headache and I assumed it. After about an hour, my head was bursting out. So I prayed about it, nothing happened. I could not do anything. It was very painful. My head was bursting out completely. So I lay down on bed, and you know what? The thoughts of death came to my life, came to my mind. I saw myself like I was dying. I knew that it was my last day on earth. And I feared, because I was looking at the people whom I leave behind, and I was worried. Hallelujah. So when you see that I'm alive today, it is a testimony. So when it comes to a point of death, I tell you, Elijah ran for his life. So when we are being told that there is grace that we should use, let us use that grace. Let us make use of the power of God that is amidst us today. Hallelujah. Amen. When you are told to pray, when you are told to go before God, let us heed to the voice of the one who is guiding us. Why? God is using them as a vessel. When that grace will be lifted, I tell you, it can be so bad in our lives. Hallelujah. Amen. Bitterness, as spoken here, leads us either to damnation or leads us to God. Look at the example in Genesis. After man was driven out of the Garden of Eden, what happened to them? They were living in Eden, but not in the garden. So they got the firstborn and the secondborn. But one time, as Abel and Cain were offering unto God, they were spiritual people like you and me, who can come and offer their sacrifices in the presence of God. Bitterness sprang up in the heart of Cain, and God spoke to him. He was very spiritual, so he heard the voice of God very well. And God spoke to him, "If you do good, will you not be reprimanded?" So it was God giving him direction. "I see bitterness in your heart, but take heed that it doesn't lead you to damnation." But what happened? The weight of negativity in that bitterness that was in him led him to damnation instead of leading him back to God. What happened after that? He slew his brother. When God spoke to him again, "Where is your brother?" He was arrogant, speaking to God, "Am I my brother's keeper?" What judgment came to him afterwards? He was moved out of the presence of God. And that is the end of the Bible ever speaking about God in communion with Cain. Hallelujah. Amen. Bitterness can lead you out of the presence of God. This is what verse 15 is saying. Looking carefully. So it means that in our walk with God, we have to be careful. When I see any form of bitterness springing in my heart against a brother or against a sister, you have to deal with it before it is too late. Because when it is too late, it will come to a point, you will repent about it, you will pray about it, but it will be a time of judgment. What is the judgment? Getting out of the presence of God. Hallelujah. Amen. There was a woman in the Bible, Jezebel. The Bible says that God was patient with her. When you read the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 21, God clearly speaks that he gave her time to repent. Yes, she was wicked. She was against God. She used to oppose God. She used to move with all forms of God at that time, but still God loved her. She was given a time to repent, but she did not repent. When you read that book of Revelation, it speaks about the judgment that is coming upon Jezebel, being cast out in darkness, even in the lake of fire. Hallelujah. Are you playing with the grace that you have been given, or you are making use of it? Bwana asifiwe. Think about it as we proceed. Another example in the Bible is the person called Peter. We can read it in the book of Matthew. It speaks about bitterness that was in Peter. The bitterness that was in Peter. Bitterness is not sin. The sin part comes on how you handle it. Because in life, it is inevitable. It will come to a point one time that you will be bitter. It will come one point in ministry, in your home, in your house, in your workplace. There will come a time when you will be bitter. But the way that you will handle the bitterness will make you righteous or sinful. Before Cain killed his brother, God saw the bitterness and warned him, "I see sin knocking on your door." Why? The weight of bitterness was too much of the negative. So bitterness is not sin. You can be hurt even amidst us. I believe that there is a time that you've been hurt by a brother or a sister. Is it true? If you have never been hurt, be prepared. One day you may be hurt. But it depends on how you will handle it. Here was Peter. He was bitter inside. Why? "I have let down Jesus Christ against my swearing." You can imagine he swore that "I will never deny you." But again, he denied Jesus swearing. We read in verse 74 there. The Bible says that then he began to curse and swear. So Peter was cursing and swearing, denying Christ. Yes, he's the one, he is the same Peter who swore not to deny him. So there may come a point in your ministry, there may come a point in your life that bitterness will come. But the Bible warns me and you, how will you handle that bitterness? Hallelujah. Peter was bitter, yes. But what did he do? Let us learn something here. He went out and wept bitterly. How do we handle bitterness? You don't handle bitterness in public. Why? When you handle it in public, you will have your ego. Your ego will push you to stand your ground, and that you'll be vulnerable to sin. Peter was bitter in his heart, so he decided, "Because I'm bitter, let me not take any action." Why? Aliona that have denied him. When I again say that I know him, I'll be crucified. So I'll be spoiling my life and that of my family. And I'll be making a controversy even in this place. What did he decide? "I will go out and weep bitterly." So he went out, wept and wept. And I believe that when he was sober, that is when he came to repentance. Hallelujah. Amen. That is how bitterness can be handled. Bitterness is what can take us out of grace. The devil cannot take you out of grace. Your wife or husband cannot take you out of grace. Your child, teacher, workmate or boss cannot take you out of grace. What can take you out of grace is the way you handle bitterness in your life. When an offense comes into you, if it doesn't result to bitterness, there's no way you can come out of grace. Hallelujah. Amen. We were given an example one time, I think, by our pastor. There was a Nigerian woman somewhere whom her friends or rivals wanted to bewitch so much. So they went and they went to a witch doctor, and they were given a direction. If you want to bewitch this woman, or if you want the charms that you want against her to work in her life, you have to make sure that she gets angry. Bwana asifiwe. In short, what was that? you have to get that woman to a point of bitterness. Then at that point she will be vulnerable. If she will act negatively, then the witchcraft against her will work. For manipulation to work in your life, for powers of darkness to work in your life, you must come to a point of bitterness. And when you mishandle that bitterness, that is when a leeway is opened, a legal ground is found to take you out of grace. Hallelujah. When you look at the ministry of Jesus, he's the person who suffered the most in this world. I believe that many times he was very bitter. There is a point that our Lord spoke that birds have nests and foxes have holes, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. I believe that at that point he was very, very bitter. Why? Anazunguka kwa ministry, akikuja mahali, maybe he's sleeping on the mountain, a prayer mountain, always like that. Always like that. He had no rest. He was very bitter. Isaiah speaks about the way that he lived, the way that he was rejected and trampled upon. This confirms that Jesus Christ was the man who was very bitter in this world. But how did he handle his bitterness? He used to move away from people. He used to pray alone. He used to seek God alone. Before he was arrested, when they were in prayer, what did he do? He went with the disciples, the three disciples who were in his inner circle, but he left them there and went further. What was he doing? Handling the bitterness in him. It is clear the way that the bitterness was in him, even before his death. He was crying to God, if it is possible, take away this cup away from me. He was very bitter at that point before he was arrested and crucified. He was very bitter. But how did he handle it? Going away, praying for the will of God. For me and you to handle bitterness which can take us out of grace is finding a quiet time somewhere, pray to God, and go back to Him. That is the intention of grace in our lives. Hallelujah.
Amen.
How many times in your life, as you've been going through, has anything been illuminated in your mind? How many times have you acted negatively when bitterness sprang in your heart? When that neighbor offended you, how did you act? When your child offended you, how did you act? When your pastor offended you, how did you act? When your husband or wife offended you, how did you act? Your boss, how did you act? We travel in matatus. When you travel and that driver or conductor spoke to you badly, how did you react? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Look into that. The way you react, open a door for separation. Open a legal ground. Works of darkness cannot be manifest in your life unless there is a legal ground. Bwana asifiwe. The life of Job, after he was struck by the devil, the Bible is clear that there is no time that God spoke ill against God. There's no time that he cursed God with his lips. Yes, he was a very bitter man, but he didn't curse or speak against God at any one time. When you read Job 42, God gives a testimony of Job, of how he endured and never spoke anything ill against him. What was his reward? A double portion of what he had before. Hallelujah. What about his friends who came? They felt even bitter about his condition. This is a generous man. He is a good man. But how comes he is undergoing all this? They felt even bitter with God. In the end, what did God say? These people have spoke badly against me. Unless they repent, I will strike them. Thank God they repented and God prayed and Job prayed for them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Job's wife, what happened? She was bitter about what they had lost. But the way that she handled that bitterness was not the way that Job handled. How did she handle? Curse God and die. That is the advice that she gave to her husband. So you can imagine, things that can happen in your life can lead you out of grace. Why? The way you react to the bitter moments in your life. When you are in the valley, how do you react? Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have to emulate Jesus. So with that, with those few remarks, look into your life. If there is any point that haunts you, you know, God gave us a conscience that when you sin or when you do wrong, it will automatically haunt you. That is the better part that God has done to us. We have the conscience part of us. So when you look into your life and you think there is a part that you missed, maybe you overreacted to a situation, you reacted negatively to a situation, you answered back to an authority negatively, it is time that we have to repent. Even as we celebrate this Easter, let it be an Easter of purification. Let it be an Easter of holiness, being sanctified by God Almighty. Hallelujah. We shall rise on our feet and we shall go before God. The prayer that we are making today is a prayer of repentance against negative actions to bitterness. Any points that you will remember, pray that God forgives you. And also, you will also pray that God strengthens your inner man, so that whenever bitterness may arise in your life in future, you may handle it the right way, because it will always come. One time it will have to come. That is the promise of Jesus. It will have to come. But unless you overcome it, you will fall a victim. Just go before God in your own words. Go before God in repentance. Repent of any negative action during your times of bitterness. And then you'll also ask for the strengthening of your inner man. Hallelujah. Father, in Jesus' name, you are great this morning. We bless you, my Father, for your amazing grace in our lives. You are the Lord who loved us. You loved us, Lord, even while we were in sin. You saw us, my Father, as a vessel of honor, that when transformed back unto you, we can be a people who will bear fruits in your kingdom. We bless you, Jehovah, my Father, because even us, your children, were walking in righteousness, as they were walking in holiness, they were awaiting for the manifestation of your power. They were awaiting for the manifestation of your grace. But my Father, my God, you did not let it happen, because you had us in your mind. They died in hope, waiting to see the manifestation of your grace. But my Father, here we are today. We are walking in your grace. We are walking, oh Lord, being fully sealed back unto you, being fully returned back unto you by the sacrifice of the blood of the Lamb that was shed at Calvary. We bless your name, Jehovah, my Father, because you love us, even as we walk in your presence as your children, even as we walk off, oh Father, in the face of the earth. You still have us in mind, and you have prepared a place for us in heaven. Today, my Father, my God, in my walk of life, there may have been a point that I have been bitter, or with my family, that I have been bitter with my bosses, oh God, or workmates. My Father, my God, there may be a time that I have been bitter with my neighbors, and I may have acted negatively and righteously. I repent of it today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Whenever I had acted negatively, when bitterness sprang in my heart, oh Lord, I plead the blood of Jesus in my life to cleanse me, to purify me, to wash me, oh Lord, so that I be clean and move in your grace again in Jesus' mighty name. Every sin that I have done, oh my Father, due to reaction to bitterness, by negative actions, by negative thinking, oh, I repent of it today in the name of Jesus. Any action that I may have taken in my life at one point in time due to negativity, after bitterness sprang in my heart, I repent of it now in Jesus' name. Lord, may you wash me, cleanse me, purify me, so that times of refreshing may prevail again in my life in Jesus' mighty name. I pray today, oh my Father in heaven, I'm the workmanship of your hand. You are the Lord who is molding me to be the person whom you have in picture in your mind. Yes, a vessel of honor to be used to bring glory unto your name. I pray today, oh Lord, for strength in my inner man. Lord, may you strengthen me in the name. name of Jesus, so that whenever bitterness may spring up in my heart, whenever I may encounter situations that call bitterness into my life, I may act righteously, I may act according to the power of your Spirit and according to the direction of your Spirit in humility and drawing back unto you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. May bitterness not move in my life just to take me away from your grace, O Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for my family, I pray for my children. May you strengthen their inner man, so that my Father, bitterness may not take them away from your presence. In the name of Jesus, we pray for this ministry, O Lord. Lead us in this ministry, our pastors, my Father. I pray that you strengthen them in the inner man, in the name of Jesus, so that no roots of bitterness may spring up in their lives and cause them to walk out of your glory, out of your presence, in the name of Jesus Christ. Give them power to endure. Give them power to control bitterness. Give them power to control themselves. For my Father, my God, the fruit of self-control is even the fruit of your Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ. Fill us with your Spirit, oh God, so that we can have that self-control in our lives, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And we shall live to glorify your name, and we shall live to elevate you, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Be glorified, O Lord. Be our God, now and forever. In Jesus' mighty and precious name we pray. Amen. Praise and worship team. You can come and lead us into the next session.